Welcome to Momentum Investing, property investing made easy. One of the world's top podcasts on property investing, bringing you the top experts in the field so you can learn firsthand what it takes to create passive income and take control over your financial future.
Welcome to the Momentum Investing Podcast. My name is Daniel Wood. I am your host for today's episode and one of the founders of Momentum Property Education. I'm really excited about today's episode because we got a Dutch investor called John Smits joining us. John is one of the members of our mastermind and has been investing almost as long as I have. He's built himself from Holland. He's built himself a lettings agency in the UK. He's got over 20 rent-to-rent properties. He's bought properties all over the UK, and he's done everything from his home in the Netherlands. He has really proven that it is possible to build a portfolio remotely, that you don't have to be in the UK to do it. You can do it from a distance. In the episode, he shares how he's done this, how he's been able to do these deals, how he's been able to build his company, and how he has succeeded with international property investing. It's a super exciting episode, one you're going to get a lot of value out of. If you want to join and do the same kind of things that he has, you can apply for the Momentum Property Education Mentorship Program at getmomentummentor.com. That's getmomentummentor.com. Or you can start our free introduction course to property investing at momentumgift.com if you're just starting out and want to dip your toes a little bit. So this episode with John is going to be amazing. So I hope you stay through the whole one. Make sure you subscribe to the Momentum Investing Podcast because we got amazing guests coming next week. You know what? I'm going to leave that as a surprise to the end of the episode, our guest for next week. So with no further ado, let's jump straight into the episode and meet John Smits and learn how he's built an international portfolio. Welcome to the Momentum Investing Podcast. I'm here with John Smits. Welcome to the show, John.
Thank you, Daniel. Hello.
Hi, we're super excited to have you here. You've been investing for a while. You've been doing it from the Netherlands into the UK. You've had an interesting journey.
Yeah, that's correct. I started already in 2014. And yeah, we are now so 7-8 years later in that. Yeah.
And so when you start, what was it that got you to start in the first place? Why did you decide to invest in the UK? Why not the Netherlands? And why invest at all in property?
Yeah. And so I started, I think 12 years ago as a contractor, self-employed, and I managed IT departments. And the money that I receive is quite good when I have an assignment. But if I don't have an assignment, then you see your savings are disappearing very fast. So I looked for ways to get money without having to work for the hour. So I started to do internet marketing. I had a web shop in wellness products, for example, that we sold already because right. That's quite a lot of work.
Yeah.
I had a blog site all about Bordeaux wines, and so I continued. And one moment of time, I get acquainted with properties in the UK, and properties was always already of interest of mine, but I never bought them. And I thought, okay, that looks nice, buy it, add value, and then rent it out. Yeah. So I did the training, I did mentorship, and I did much more trainings. And that was the start. So we did some trainings and a mentorship in London. And then we bought the first houses of apartments in Glasgow. And from there on, it grew. We did joint ventures, we did service accommodations. And yeah, so we have now a portfolio of some properties, yes.
So why did you choose the UK and not the Netherlands, for example? Why did you end up there?
Yeah, so in the trainings, there's always told that it is quite easy to get tenants in it. And if they are not paying, then you can get out of it. That's the first. So in practice, it's not so easy. That I learned after a few years, of course.
Yeah.
but when you do it in the Netherlands, when you buy a house and you rent it out, then it is much more difficult than in the UK to get people out of it.
Right.
When when there are people that are not paying, and it is winter, for example, and they have children and a whole family, then the judge can say, okay, I know you have to pay and you don't pay yet, but you can still pay in the property and the landlord doesn't get any money. So that's quite bad. And the Dutch government is not so in favor with the, with the landlords. Right. So they don't treat them very well. In the UK, there's a whole market around landlords, and that is not there in the Netherlands. So
right. So that makes it much more beneficial to invest in the UK.
Yeah, and then the return on investments in the UK are much better than in the Netherlands. Mm. If you get on a buy-to-let in the Netherlands 1-5%, then it is quite nice. And in the UK, you get much higher returns.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I mean, the Netherlands is in many ways very similar to Sweden. So it's kind of the same reasons why we chose to invest in the UK. And I mean, we started at about the same time with the same company that taught us both. And it turned out to be a little harder, though, than they made it sound. So what have been some of the lessons you've gotten on the way? Because you've done a little bit of everything. So what have you learned?
What did I learn? A lot about joint ventures, and that in the beginning, everything looks fine and you have almost a happy marriage. Mm-hmm. But later on, you see that people are reacting different and doing things different than they tell in the beginning.
Yeah.
So one of the big lessons is get the joint venture partners, get to know them very well before you step into them, especially when you start limited companies with them.
Yeah.
So that is one big lesson that I learned. We had some joint ventures that were not so good, and we had some that were good. So
We did a great episode about this with Chris Cooper about how to identify quality joint venture partners. And so if anyone listening, if you want, go back a few episodes to the one with Chris Cooper. It's really, really good on how to choose the right joint venture partners. But so John, how did you find the good ones, and how have you learned to kind of recognize that now when it's going to be good or not so good?
Yeah. So in Newcastle, there I have now a joint venture partner that I work already for 4 years with him. And since half year, we do it together in the company.
Right.
So we learned each other to know very well.
So he was sourcing for you first, and then you joint ventured later? Or how did you start working together?
No. Yeah, I have in Newcastle, I have several rent-to-rent apartments and houses. Right. And he was the intermediate between the landlord and myself. So he works with all Chinese people, with people from Hong Kong. And so then we got one property via him, and then the second one. And later on it continued. So
Right. And then that relationship grew into a joint venture.
Yeah.
I think that's a good way, because that way, I mean, obviously money has kind of gone between you in the past, and you've seen how he acts around money. I think that, because that to me has been one of the big things with joint venture partners, is it's usually very good until money enters the picture. And then either it continues good, or, that's when the true colors kind of come out, right?
Yeah. And even with one of the joint venture partners, we did the wealth dynamics test, and we had the same profile, and it looked quite promising, but in the end it didn't. So
So what's gone wrong when you've done joint ventures? What's been, if you want to share some of the issues that's kind of come up?
We had joint ventures with people that are locally there. So especially when you do service accommodation, then they think, okay, I have to do all the running around, and John is sitting in the Netherlands and doing nothing, for example. That's a discussion that you can have. In practice, in reality, I'm quite busy with marketing the properties, getting them good on the websites, on booking.com and Airbnb and stuff. And it takes a lot of time. but they don't see it. And then the balance is wrong. And it, if you don't manage that well, then you are going to split again.
Yeah, that's so a good insight. Yeah, because everyone sees obviously the work they do all the time, but sometimes you don't notice the work that everyone else around you does. And it's that can obviously create a feeling that you're working much harder than everyone else, which isn't always true.
And sometimes you bring in knowledge and work that is not visible, but the other side doesn't see it that way. So, but we had also good joint ventures. We have an HMO in Crewe. We have there an investor in the Netherlands. We have a local person there, and we have a joint venture with the three of us. And that works quite well. So,
So your role essentially was putting those two together, and then you're the intermediary between. Is that?
Yeah.
Very good.
So I have the same position as you in the golf resort, I think.
Yeah.
So bringing in no money, but earning money from that deal.
Exactly. The perfect position to be in, right? You have one partner who does all the work. You have one partner that gives all the money, and you take a share of everything. Very good. Very good.
Yeah.
So what are you doing now? What is your big focus property-wise now?
Yeah, so the last 3 years, I was fully focused on service accommodation, bringing it live and expanding it. So we have around Newcastle area, we have around 20 apartments there, and that we manage there. But you see now, especially when you are not there for a whole year because of COVID, then it is quite difficult to manage your team there. So I don't want to expand that too much at the moment. I'm still expanding, but not so much anymore. And my focus is now to get new property deals, so that we buy a property and rent them out later on.
Right. So instead of doing more rent to rents, you're acquiring property now again.
Yeah. And we started already the process last year, at the end of last year. No, not the end, but in September. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then we said, okay, we want to buy a two-bedroom apartment. And I must say, it took some time before we got a bridge loan, but we have it now. And last Tuesday, that was the completion of it. So now the builders are in. And it took some time. So,
yeah, I know.
So when you say in, so when you say in August, yes, I want the property, and you give all the documentation and everything, and then it takes time till February. So it's quite a long time.
Yeah, absolutely. And you say you use the bridge to buy that property?
Yeah, we have a bridge loan with a company. Of course, that's a one-time use of that company because it was ridiculous what they are asking. And not in the sense of the amount of interest we have to pay, but more on the paperwork.
Yeah.
So we had discussions so that I have to send in proof of address and stuff like that. And then we deliver it. And then in January, they say, yeah, they are too old. They are older than 3 months. Yeah, of course, when you take so long.
Yeah, exactly. I sent them in to you in August. Yes, that was more than 3 months ago. Oh, that's horrible.
Or we have, in the UK, you have credit reports for all the individual people. But in the Netherlands, you don't have it. So there is something that looks familiar with the UK, and I could only send screenshots. And they were fine in November when when they had them all. Yeah. And the last day, so on Tuesday, they suddenly said, yeah, we need an update on that. I said, an update on it? It were screen prints without a date. But still, they needed an update. So completely ridiculous.
Oh man, that's nuts. But you so finally then I said, completed.
I was quite clear to the lender that I won't supply the additional information, and I wanted to complete. That was last Tuesday, and otherwise I would stop with it, I said. And somehow it went through. Yeah.
Wow. So. And that worked. That's well done.
Yeah. And so most of the time I'm quite nice to my team and everybody, but this time I was really mad to him. So
well done. Well, hey, it worked, right? It worked. So something to learn from. Yeah. Next time, of course, as a mastermind member, you got access to the crowd fund. So we'll use that instead.
Yeah, we are looking into it to see how we can manage that. So,
sounds good.
So, but we'll come back to that later on.
So where are you looking for deals right now? Where are you trying to buy right now?
Yeah, for me, the areas are not so important. So I have properties in Glasgow. I have them in near Manchester, Newcastle. And now the one that we just bought is in Barnes in Furness. I think I've pronounced it quite nice. It's near Preston.
Right.
So the area is not so important, but it's more that you have a good return on investment and you know you have trustful people locally there that can manage the property for you. That is really important.
So how do you go about finding your sourcing agents? What's been the key for you there?
And so the property that is now sourced, that is by sourced by an agent where I already have contact with since 2014.
Right.
We never did a deal directly. Indirectly, I still have contact and a property of them. But now they have had a good deal and I know how they work. So it was really trustful. And that's the reason why I stepped into it. If they are not trustful, that's first, then I don't invest in it.
So for someone else, someone listening, though, who maybe doesn't want to wait 7 years to get to know someone, how would you go about then finding a quality agent?
Yeah, so one of the things is now with the mastermind, which I stepped in a few months ago, they are trust on the people that you have put in. So you are trustful to me. So then you must also
better deliver now.
Yes.
But that is true. That is what we've tried to create in the mastermind, is that little shortcut so you don't have to take that 7-year due diligence kind of process.
Yeah. In practice, you don't have to do it, of course. But it takes some time when you have new people to get to know them. And especially the people can be trustful and the deal can be right. But on the back end, you must have a team there, the builders and the contractors and everybody who does the build, the refurbishment, that must be trustful and working well. And that I have seen in the past, the quality is not always good of these people, and especially not the work that they deliver. So,
Agreed. So if you can leave our listeners here with some parting words of wisdom from your journey, what would you say if you could give someone one piece of advice on their journey?
I think that you can do everything alone, but if you do it together with other people, then you can grow much faster, and a coach or a mentor can help you in that. So
I love it. That's great advice. Thank you. So if someone wants to kind of connect with you, follow your journey, see your properties, how can they reach you?
Yeah, we have one of my websites is Welcome Home Apartments, and there are all my service accommodations. So there you can find my properties that I have. You have a view of the properties around Newcastle, and there's also my contact information. So this www.welcomehomeapartments.co.uk.
Perfect. I'll add that in the show notes so everyone has that clear and simple as well.
Okay. Awesome.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much for joining us here today, John. And everyone.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah, thank you so much. Everyone listening, thank you so much for joining us. I have some good news for you in a moment, so please stay tuned.
Isn't that amazing? John proves that it is possible to build a property portfolio remotely. He's done it. You can do it. We can all do it. Let's make it happen, right? So super exciting. And next week, I have another exciting guest coming, we have none other than Tim Cooley. Tim has literally written the book on how to raise money for venture capital. How do you raise for your startup? How do you raise money for your business? Now, a lot of this is venture capital in kind of regular type of companies, not for property investing. You know what? The lessons turned out to be very much the same. The same process that he goes through is the same one I use when I raise money for our property investing. So this episode is going to be incredibly, incredibly valuable. So make sure you subscribe to the Momentum Investing Podcast so that when the episode with Tim comes out, you get notified right away. Because if you want to raise more money, if you want to do more deals, you need to listen to this episode. All right. So subscribe to the Momentum Investing Podcast. And now if you want to build a portfolio just like John did, make sure you apply for the mentorship program at getmomentummentor.com. That's getmomentummentor.com. One word, nothing strange. Getmomentummentor.com. If you're just starting out, go to momentumgift.com and listen to the free introduction course where you'll learn the three simple steps to property investing. Super excited to have you here. Super excited to be working with you. Thank you so much for joining us, and I'll see you next week.